See you. Well, you know, ladies and gentlemen, one of the most wonderful things in the world that I have found is that when God steps into your life and literally becomes a part of it, where you know that it's Him that's doing something in your life. When you know it's Him that's giving you understanding and unlocking something for you. We need to understand that the Word of God is like that. It is locked up for those people that don't have the Spirit of God to unlock it. There are things that, unless you have the Spirit of God living in you, unless you are born again, you will not get it. And so we pray right now. That was why my prayer is for anybody that's out there that needs to come to an understanding of what it is that we're going to be talking about, that it would be unlocked for you today.
Yes.
Should you get it.
Yes.
When I first came to the Lord, it was a problem. See, I had a problem. The problem that I had was that I did not believe in Jesus Christ. Do you believe that? I didn't believe in Jesus. I mean, I believed that He existed, and I believed that the Bible said He was the Son of God, but I did not believe that He was God. And there may be some of you out there now that have that same problem. There may be some of you out there now that can't understand how Jesus can be God. This is a very, very important thing. Do you know that? In fact, Jesus Himself says, in John 8:24, He says, you will die in your sins, and unless you believe that I am, you will die in your sins. So this is a very, very important doctrine, ladies and gentlemen, that we need to get, that we need to understand. And there's many people that come in. In fact, even some of the people that have been in the church for a long time do not understand this particular doctrine called the Trinity. And so I wanted to speak to you today from the title of this sermon called Jesus, Gem Above All Gems. Amen? And my focus statement of the day is that we need to understand and identify the intrinsic value, substance, brilliance, and beauty of the glory that only Jesus possesses. And my function statement is that to gain that understanding as our journey continues to seek after and perceive His intrinsic value. Now, before we get started, ladies and gentlemen, I want to ask if you know what the word intrinsic means. A lot of people don't know what that means. The definition of the word intrinsic means, and I quote, being a part of the innermost nature of a person or thing. In this sermon today, we're going to discuss the intrinsic worth, substance, brilliance, and beauty of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, but before we can talk about that, we need to look at the very nature of our Lord and Savior. The nature of God. Now, with a show of hands, how many of you would be able to explain right now the doctrine of the Trinity? Show me by hands. If somebody asked you to explain the Trinity to them, would you be able to? Oh, that's interesting. Not a whole lot of people understand the doctrine of the Trinity. Isn't that true? You know, the Holy Spirit was speaking to me, and He said, because I always ask Him, what does He want me to preach about? And I can see why He's wanted me to bring this to you today. This is important. Now, don't feel bad if you can't explain the doctrine, because most people can't. In fact, most Christians just kind of sort of accept it. They accept it, especially if they were raised in the church. Thank you, that feels great. A little warm up in here, you know what I mean? Now, many Christians were taught the Trinity from childhood up, and even though they might not understand it, they've come to accept it as truth, because that's all they knew. Amen? That's all they knew. The doctrine itself is a difficult thing to fathom. And to be truthful with it, we cannot understand it on our own. Do you understand? We cannot understand it on our own. It takes the Holy Spirit to unlock it so that we can have a heavenly perception. A heavenly perception of the nature of God rather than only an earthly one. Now, why am I telling you all of this right now? It's because we are about to look at a scripture that has been the source of much confusion and misunderstanding, even among the body of Christ and the Christian community at large. But once you come to understand the nature of God a little bit better, then you will also be able to fathom everything else about Him. Turn your Bibles to John 1, please. We're going to read 1 through 3, and then we're going to jump down to 14 and read that. And let's stand for the reading of the Word of God, please. John 1, 1 through 3, and then 14. You guys got your Glocks out there? That's your Glock. See, back in the old days, it was a sword. Today, it's a Glock. Amen? Of course, last week it was Mac-10s, but that's okay. Whatever your weapon is, the weapon of God. Amen? Amen? Give me an amen when you find this scripture.
Amen.
All right. And the Word of God says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word, and then it says, and He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through Him.
Yes.
And apart from Him, nothing came into being that has come into being. And then we jump down to the 14th verse, and it says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we saw His glory, glory as the only, of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Let's be seated. Now this happens to be the verse of Scripture that God used to bring me to Christ. There anybody in here that belongs to Jesus Christ? There was a time when God was pulling you towards Him.
Yes, it was.
It had been, you had been given to Christ. Okay, God had granted it that you would come to Christ. But you know, the thing is that how can you come to Christ if you don't know Him? Amen?
Amen.
So it was difficult to come to Christ unless something would happen. And so God had to move in my life and answer some questions.
Yes.
And let me tell you something that's wonderful about your God and my God. He'll meet you right where you're at. Amen?
Amen?
He'll meet you right where you're at. It doesn't really matter. You've got a question, and especially one as serious as this, God will meet you, and He will answer your question. Have I got stories for you? Now, in the beginning of my walk with Christ, like I said, I was never the type that could just accept something as truth. Something that somebody told me, especially when it came to Christian doctrine. Because I was so misled through everything that I went through when I was coming up. I couldn't give much credence to something that I couldn't understand. I know that many of you know what I'm talking about. There's many, because everybody that's out here, a lot of us, we've come from different backgrounds, haven't we? And the backgrounds that we came through, people told us all kinds of stuff. And they got religions out there telling you so much stuff that's off the wall, man, it's just unbelievable. And so it was difficult for us. And when we finally came to the truth, what a wonderful and refreshing thing that was. Amen? Do you remember when you first started reading the Bible that you would read a couple of verses or maybe even pages, and then you would just close up the book and put it down because nothing in it made sense? Do you remember that? Man, I remember I'd sit down, open up the Bible, I'd start reading, and I'd go, what is that? And I'd close it up and put it down. None of it made any difference. It didn't make any sense to me. And if you're honest about it, you remember thinking to yourself, what was that all about? I mean, I didn't understand a thing about what it was talking about. I would read something in that book, and it would seem like somebody just started mixing up the words. Like somebody stuck their finger in it. Was just, and I'm like, what's going on here? It was scrambling them up, and I couldn't understand a single thing. And it would frustrate me so bad that I would just close the book and just stop trying. I did not realize what it was going to take for me to get it. You see, I was of the mentality that I could read, if I could read something, I should be able to understand it. Isn't that the way that we think?
Right.
We think that if I can read it, then I should be able to put together the thoughts to get it, to understand what's going on. And as many of you probably the same, you might be of the same mindset as me. I know this brother over here is. But that's not the way that the Bible works. So let's ask, how does the Bible work then? Turn your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 2. We're going to read 12 through 14. 1 Corinthians 2, 12 through 13. I mean 12 through 14, excuse me. 1 Corinthians 2, 12 through 14, and the Word of God says, "Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, so that we may know the things freely given to us by God, which things we also speak, not in words taught by human wisdom, but in those taught by the Spirit, combining spiritual thoughts with spiritual words." Now listen to this. This is the important part. It says, "But a natural man does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them, because they are spiritually appraised." Do you understand that, what it's saying? As brilliant and as smart as some of us think that we are, this stuff that we're not going to get. When I teach Bible studies here, sometimes we have a gentleman that likes to come into the Bible study and disrupt. He's the guy that likes to come in, he does a lot of reading. And he comes in, and he does a lot of reading, he even reads the Bible. But when he reads the Bible, he doesn't have the Spirit of God helping him. And so what happens? He takes Scripture all out of context and thinks that he understands it, and he doesn't. And it's just a shame, because if he would allow the Spirit of God to enter his heart and to unlock the Scripture to him, he would be a wonderful, wonderful asset to the kingdom. But he doesn't allow that to happen. So we can see that according to the Bible, that the things of God that are revealed in this book, right here, are explained to us through the help of the Holy Spirit. Now, why is this so important? Because what we are about to discuss, you will need the help of the Holy Spirit in order to understand it. So before we get started, let's pray a special prayer. And let's ask God to bring knowledge and understanding to those who are truly hungry for this communication and are ready to accept the evidence of who Jesus really and truly is. And this is going to forever proclaim his intrinsic value and worth. If you get this, you're going to understand this from now on. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as you know, Lord, in the middle of this sermon, we're lifting up this prayer, Lord, because I want to ask a special request. We pray, Lord, right now, that all of your children that are sitting out here, those whose hearts are hungry to know you, Lord Jesus, those of you who are out here, those of your children that are out here, Lord, that you are drawing to Jesus Christ right now, and give them understanding. We pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that right now, the way that you unlocked it for me, that you would unlock it for them. Lord, I pray that today, when they leave this place, they're going to understand and know right now who Jesus Christ is and how he is God in flesh form. So, Lord, thank you so much for being there for us. We know, Lord, that you are the one that explains all things to us. And so thank you for what you're going to do here today. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. Amen. Now, what we're going to focus on is John 1:1. And the reason why I want to do that is that that's the scripture that the Lord used to bring me to him. And so I want to share with you what he shared with me, what he showed me. Amen? My problem, my question was, how can Jesus be God? Now, some of you might be thinking the same thing. How is it that that happened? How could Jesus be God? I mean, if you read the Bible at all, or you've been in any Bible studies, you know that Jesus was on earth, and he was praying to somebody up there, wasn't he? So if God is up there, why are you trying to tell me that Jesus is God? That didn't make any sense to me. Did it make sense to you? I mean, can you see the confusion? There's a lot of things that happen. In fact, as I was sitting there, I was with a whole lot of the place that I was at, I was going through rehab. I was trying to get rid of my cocaine problem when I was in a place where I could finally understand, when I could finally approach this situation and ask God who he was. And it was predominantly Baptist. And so I'm sitting there and I'm arguing with people.
Jesus ain't God. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus ain't God.
And they're going, no, 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 Jesus is God. And I said, well, wait a minute, who was Jesus praying to then? I was so filled with myself. I was so prideful thinking, you can't tell me that. You can't tell me that. I mean, but I started having problems because every time I'd open up the Bible and I would read something that told me that Jesus was God, I'm like, what? John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now, the Bible that I was used to reading from was the Bible that the Jehovah's Witnesses had, because my mother was one. And that said, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was a God. So you say, it threw a whole bunch of mess in there, so I couldn't get it, couldn't understand it. But then as I was discussing things, I would read John 8:58, where Jesus was speaking, and he told the Jews that he was talking, he says, before Abraham, I am. Now, if you know anything about Jewish history and the way that the Jews believe, there were always anybody who, I mean, when God declared who he was, who did he say he was? But remember, he said, I am that I am. So the Jews knew that whenever anybody said, I am, they were talking about God. So Jesus told him, he said, before Abraham, I am. So he was telling them that he was God. And I said, well, okay, I got that one. And then all of a sudden they would bring up John 10:30, where Jesus says, I and the Father are one. Wait a minute. What do you mean I and the Father are one? I love Jesus. I mean, I love God, but me and the Father ain't one. I mean, I'm trying, but that ain't the way it is. And so I didn't really get that. But then the one that really kicked me in the teeth was when they brought up John 14:8, where Jesus says, if you have seen me, you have seen the Father. Amen? That doesn't leave a whole lot to wonder about, does it? Jesus himself is telling you, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So I would pray to God and I would say, Lord, what do you mean? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I said, why do you say things? If you really wrote that and put that in the Bible, why would you do that? Don't you know that that's going to confuse people? You know, I know that God had to be, Jesus had to be looking at me going, that's my boy. You see, but what he knew is that he knew he was going to bring me to a place where I was going to understand. Amen? Now, I'm going to show you what God showed me. Because my question was, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Well, I asked the question, I said, who is the Word? Is there somebody running around out there named Word? I mean, with all honesty, I asked them that question. Is that what's happening? Is there somebody out there that's running around that's named Word? And then the Lord brought the answer to me. And I want you to listen very closely. The Word that it's talking about here in this scripture is the spoken expression of God. You understand? The spoken expression of God. Now, what does that mean? That means, see, God is not like you and me. We speak the Word, and our words go out, and they fall upon the ears of people who are listening, and they get the message. Okay? But that's it. But God's words are different. When He speaks a word, everything that comes out of His mouth has life in itself and can live apart and distinct from God. You understand? That's why He's God. That's why He's God. His very words that He speaks have a life in and of themselves, by themselves. That's the reason why God could speak everything into existence. Let there be light. Well, the words went out and created light. That's why it tells us in John, the first chapter, it tells us that everything that was created by Him. Talking about Jesus, the Word. So the spoken expression came from God. The word went out in itself and had life in itself and did what God wanted it to do. Wanted him to do. Amen? So we need to understand that that's who the Word of God is talking about in John 1. Now, that Word that spoke, was spoken by God went out and God wrapped flesh around it and he came to earth in the form of Jesus Christ. Amen? That is how Jesus is God. Do you understand? That's how he is God. Important to know. So, like I said, there's probably somebody out there today that's been in the dark about that truth for a long time. And you might have been asking God for an explanation of some time, and at some time also. And if you are, you know, anything like me, you might have been in a place where you finally were ready to follow God and be obedient to his word, but you didn't know how. Because you didn't know him. You didn't know who he truly was. You didn't know whether or not to worship him. I was in a place where I couldn't worship him because I thought that worshiping Jesus would be idolatry. Because since I didn't believe he was God, I couldn't worship him. But now that I know that he's God, it's easy to worship him. We know who he is. So what was I supposed to worship him, or was I just to acknowledge him? Or is he not? Who is he truly? And what makes up his substance? Now, as we contemplate these questions and ask God for clarity, we will be able to come to an understanding of the value and the work of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who is also known as God in flesh form.
Amen.
Now, let's talk about his substance. What is Jesus' substance? In other words, what is he made of?
Right.
Now, I'm not talking about whether he is spirit or flesh. Or what his body is made of. But I'm talking about what is he made up of inside.
Amen.
What is it that is inside him that makes up his character? Well, remember what the 14th verse of John said. It says, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. Full of grace and truth. I don't know about you, but that is such a wonderful and beautiful thing to understand about God, amen? About Jesus Christ. Grace and truth. Now let's look at both of these attributes for a minute. And let's dissect them in order to get a deeper understanding of them. And with that deeper understanding, we can come to know Jesus just a little bit better. Now the word grace means unmerited favor. Unmerited favor or assistance. In other words, favor that we don't deserve.
Thank you, sir.
Okay? So when we look to Jesus, what is it that you see? Do you look to him with a proud look, expecting something because you feel that you've been cheated?
No.
Is that the way you look at him?
No.
Do you feel that life has not been good enough to you? You might feel that way because, you know, because we're down here. Skid Row. We're down here in Skid Row. Some of us don't have jobs, no place to live, not enough to eat in some cases. But if we're honest with ourselves, we have to ask ourselves the question, who put us down here?
Thank you.
Amen? Who put us down here? I mean, you know, when we're honest with each other, I know that I'm honest with me. I know why I'm here. I know how I ended up here. Amen? Here. And then as we analyze ourselves, we know that there is nobody to blame but ourselves. We know what we've been doing. Our behavior has been atrocious. And I know the reason why I'm down here. I tried to shoot up all the dope in Compton. Okay? I tried to smoke off all of my cars and my jewelry and my wife's jewelry. My house. In fact, two houses. When we get a chance to honestly look at ourselves, we know exactly why we're here. And we know that we don't deserve anything but a burning, eternal hell. That's what we all deserve. You understand? If it wasn't for Jesus, what would we do? What would we do?
Praise God for Jesus. Amen. Because if it weren't for Him, we would all be lost forever. We'd be lost forever, separated from God for an eternity. Never to see the light of day again. If it weren't for Him paying the price for my sin, I would have to pay it myself. And believe me, people, nobody gets out of this without answering for our conduct. Anybody that's out there doing what you're doing, if you're doing something you know that you ain't supposed to be doing it, don't think that you're going to skip to my loo, my darling, and everything's going to be cool. We all got to stand before Him. Either Jesus pays the price for you, lavishing His grace and unmerited favor upon you, or you pay for it yourself. That's why it doesn't make any sense to me. Why would anybody turn down this wonderful free gift that God has given you? All you got to do is say, yes, Lord, I'm a sinner. Please help me. Forgive me, Lord. Help me. Save me. Because I can't save myself. And if you think that you're good enough to settle accounts with God by your own righteousness, you are sadly mistaken. Because nobody is good enough. Nobody measures up to His standard except Jesus Christ Himself. Listen, the Apostle Paul did not measure up. Okay? Who else? Billy Graham, he doesn't measure up. The Virgin Mary did not measure up. Okay? Who's that? Mother Teresa. Does not measure up. Only Jesus Christ measured up. On our best day, we are no good. Do you understand? We are no good, and in all we deserve is hell. So if you want to know what Jesus is made up of inside, it is mercy and grace. Thank God. What is that? The grace? Grace is so that we have unmerited favor. In other words, He gives us favor even though we don't have it coming. We don't deserve it. And He gives us mercy. That means that He loves us and He shows that mercy to each one of us. He wants to save you, ladies and gentlemen. He wants to give you another chance to do it right. And He's willing to help you because it's obvious that we didn't do it right this time. I mean, some of us, yeah, we went to school and we became doctors and lawyers and all that kind of stuff. But for the most part, none of us did it right. I know I didn't. I went to school, got out, couldn't wait to get out of school. I couldn't wait. I'm in my senior year, and they expelled me. And I said, okay, it's okay with me. And I went on about my business. I didn't realize that I was going to need an education until I turned 55 years old. So I went back to school. Amen? Which, by the way, I'm about to graduate in June. Amen. He is giving us another chance, ladies and gentlemen, to do it right this time. Now, I confess that I didn't do it right for the first 36 years of my life. But I will be doggone if I don't take advantage of this second chance that He's giving me now. What kind of fool would I be if I keep making the same mistakes that I made for those first 36 years? What kind of fool would any of us be to keep doing it? Listen. You know what they say, if you keep doing the same thing, expecting different results, what is that called? Insanity. Okay? And I don't want to be considered insane. If we want anything in our lives to turn out differently, we need to turn our lives over to the One that is filled with grace and truth. So now, in conclusion, let me ask you a question. Did you know that it is impossible for God to lie? It's impossible. It's impossible for Him to lie. Because when He speaks, His words leave His mouth and they go and accomplish exactly what He says that they will. Remember, God spoke an expression, the Word, created all things. He cannot speak an untruth. So we can always believe what Jesus says. His truth stands forever and will always be immutable. Never changing and forever dependable. So when we examine the intrinsic value of Jesus Christ, we need to understand, we can come to understand His work, because He is God. And is there anything better than that? Nothing. So when Jesus Christ is living in you,
And he is your Savior, and he is your friend, and he is your brother. There is nobody. The Bible says he's closer than a brother. Amen? We finally begin to understand his substance. Because he's full of grace and truth, and because of these facts, his brilliance and beauty are beyond compare.
My name is Anthony Stallworth, and I'm a senior pastor at Central City Community Church of the Nazarene. We're located at 419 East 6th Street, downtown Los Angeles, on the corner of 6th and San Pedro. We are a church that serves the Skid Row community, so I'm sure that you can imagine that it's difficult for us to support our ministry with the tithes and the offerings. If today's message has helped you, perhaps you would like to come alongside Central City and prayerfully consider helping support this ministry by sending your tax-deductible gift to Central City Community Church, P.O. Box 13273, Los Angeles, California, 90013.